welcomes to you on this lovely sunny Sunday as we gather in St. Columba Church for our service of worship and our participation in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. We hear these words of the psalmist, "Ascribe to the Lord, O families of nations, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name, bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth." So let us join to worship God as we sing our opening hymn, a well-known hymn by John Newton. It's number 421 in the hymnary, "Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion, city of our God."
Thank you.
have our Old Testament reading, which is from the book of Judges, and reading from chapter 7, verses 1 to 8.
Listen for the word of the Lord. Gideon defeats the Midianites. Early in the morning, Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all his men camped at the spring of Harod. The camp of Midian was north of them in the valley near the hill of Moreh. The Lord said to Gideon, "You have too many men for me to deliver Midian into their hands. In order that Israel may not boast against me that her own strength has saved her, announce now to the people, anyone who trembles with fear may turn back and leave Mount Gilead." So 22,000 men left, while 10,000 remained. But the Lord said to Gideon, "There are still too many men. Take them down to the water, and I will sift them out for you there. If I say, 'This one shall go with you,' he shall go. But if I say, 'This one shall not go with you,' he shall not go." So Gideon took the men down to the water. There the Lord told him, "Separate those who lap the water with their tongues like a dog from those who kneel down to drink." 300 men lapped with their hands to their mouths. All the rest got down on their knees to drink. The Lord said to Gideon, "With the 300 men that lapped, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hands. Let all the other men go, each to his own place." So Gideon sent the rest of the Israelites to their tents, but kept the 300 who took over the provisions and trumpets of the others. Amen.
Thank you, Isabel. Through the prophet Jeremiah, the Lord says to us, "Call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know." So let us pray. Our gracious God and Father, as we gather in your house today to worship you, we want to have a renewed awareness of your greatness, because there belongs to you such majesty and power and splendor and holiness as our little minds cannot grasp. We want to come before you with a true love for you, with an awe-inspiring sense of how much you deserve to be praised. We also want to come before you, Lord, with a deepened understanding of your great love and mercy extended to us in Jesus Christ, your Son. We want to appreciate more of his loveliness, the perfection of his character, the lowliness of his life of service, the deep self-sacrifice of the death he died for us, the power and the victory of his resurrection life. As we come before you, Lord, we want to come with a truer sense of our own weakness, unable truly to worship you, unable to live for you or serve you, without the great strengthening power of your Holy Spirit. So we want to open ourselves now to the Holy Spirit's power, that our singing and our praying, our speaking and our hearing may bring glory to your name and blessing to your people. We pray that today you will nourish us both by the truth of your word and the sustenance of the sacrament as we bring our broken lives before you. Grant that in Christ's wounds we may find our healing In his brokenness, our wholeness, and in his death, our life. All this we pray for his great name's sake. Amen. We sing the hymn number 443, a doughty hymn of faith by the great 17th century Christian writer John Bunyan. Who would true valor see? Let him come hither. Hymn 443.
Found on page 1048 of your pew Bibles. The cost of being a disciple. Large crowds were travelling with Jesus, and turning to them he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, Everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, "This fellow began to build and was not able to finish." Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able, with 10,000 men, to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation, while the other is still a long way off, and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure heap. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Amen, and may God bless this reading.
Thank you, Raymond. So we now continue our worship as we bring to God our offering. The offering will now be uplifted. Should have said earlier in the service that we are very grateful to Donald McIntosh, who has come to play the organ today at very short notice. Our regular organist Paul phoned in to say he wasn't well this morning, and we're very glad that Donald was able to step in. So let us pray. Our gracious Father, as we bring these gifts to you, help us to bring them with a thankful heart. We have so much for which to thank you. We thank you for the brightness and the warmth of this day and all the signs of the awakening earth around us. And as the sun shines on us, so the brightness of your saving love shines on us in the face of Jesus Christ. And even when our lives may be shadowed by darkness, and by suffering and by loss, we praise you for the assurance that your mercies do not fail, that they are new every morning. So we pray for the sick and the suffering, asking that you will touch their lives with your patient love and your sustaining power. Remember those who in recent weeks and months have known the desolation of bereavement. We pray that you will send shafts of light into their sorrow and draw them nearer to the Saviour who bears our sins and all our griefs. We pray for our suffering world, for all those places where there is conflict and bloodshed and fear. We pray for all displaced peoples who seek, sometimes rather desperately, to find a haven of refuge in other lands. And we pray for all who are destitute and suffering, that appropriate help may reach them through the ministry of those who are able to extend the willing hand and the loving heart. And so we pray too for our own nation as the time approaches for an important decision to be made in connection with our relationship with the continent of Europe. We pray that you will give to our political leaders and to all the voters in our land wisdom and discernment, so that what is best not just for our own land but for other lands and other people may be governed by your goodwill, and that your people may be made strong to show the love and the grace and the concern of Christ across the whole world. So bless us now as we dedicate these gifts to you and pray that they will be used for the glory of your name and the furtherance of your kingdom through Christ our Lord. Amen. We sing the hymn number 442, Fight the Good Fight with All Thy Might. Christ is thy strength, and Christ thy right. Lay hold on life, and it shall be thy joy and crown eternally. 442.
Luke chapter 14 at verse 25,
large crowds were travelling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yea, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple." Our two scripture readings today alert us to the fact that both God the Father and Jesus the Son are wary of crowds. In the Gideon story from the book of Judges, a huge Midianite and Amalek This huge Midianite and Amalekite alliance is about to invade Israel, and Gideon, who has felt the call of God on his life at this time of crisis, assembles an Israelite army 32,000 strong to confront the enemy. He has already received the assurance that God will grant him. Strike us as strange, considering the size of the opposing force. Later on in the chapter, we're told that the Midianites, the Amalekites, and all the other eastern peoples had settled in the valley thick as locusts. Their camels could no more be counted than the sand on the seashore. To where is his journey taking him? Well, ultimately, it's taking him to Jerusalem and to his cross. It is part of his utterly committed giving of himself to the finishing of the work that the Father has given him to do. At this point in that journey, these large crowds are keeping company with him, apparently in an attitude of fervent enthusiasm. They appear to be fans of Jesus. So shouldn't he be rather pleased that they're there? Well, Jesus clearly has his doubts about them, because he's never looking for fans, he's looking for disciples, and that's a very different thing. So he doesn't seek to swell the crowds, he sets out to sift them. It is well known that crowds are capricious and easily manipulated. Their emotions can easily be played upon. Many years ago, I remember speaking to two young men, two very decent young men from the Western Isles, and in the course of the conversation, they admitted that when they first came to Glasgow and got into the habit of going to the big football matches, they sometimes got involved in the violence that can erupt on such occasions. When I said to them, given the kind of upbringing you had and given the norms of behavior in the communities from which you come, don't you find it rather astonishing that you could engage in that kind of behavior? And the only explanation they could find was that the mood of the crowd took over. They succumbed to the mass emotion. Whole libraries of books have been written on crowd psychology. An early influential author in the field was a man called Gustave Le Bon, whose volume, The Crowd, A Study of the Popular Mind, was published in 1895. Le Bon suggested that when people became part of a crowd, they commonly lose almost all of their individuality and their personal judgment and morality, becoming caught up in the crowd's collective and often irrational influence. When we see these old films of the Nazi rallies in Germany in the 1930s, where people listened to Adolf Hitler's frenzied rantings, it's easy for us now to wonder how intelligent people could fall under the spell of such a monster. But can we be absolutely sure that if we were there at the time, we wouldn't have succumbed in any degree to his sinister magnetism? So Jesus seems to sense that these large crowds who traveled with him at this point are being borne along in a wave of shallow emotionalism, and he asks them to cool it, to think things through, to count the cost, really to appreciate what it will mean to become a disciple of his. The word disciple, of course, is related to that demanding word, discipline. And to underline the demanding nature of Christian discipleship, Jesus, say, first of all, makes a very stark statement, which he then reinforces with a couple of little parables, before concluding with a warning about the uselessness of a less than total commitment. So first of all, the stark statement. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. We must first of all deal with this word, hate. Of course, Jesus is not telling us actively to hate our nearest and dearest. For the sake of emphasis, he's using a Semitic idiom which employs the word hate in the sense of give second place to. Jesus says that because discipleship means not just coming to him, but following him, going with him to the end of the journey, then there is nothing in our life, not even the closest and most precious of human relationships, that can be allowed to take priority over his claims. If we are to be truly his, then everything must be surrendered to him, even our very life. He says, anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Now, we have taken that phrase about carrying the cross out of its context, and we commonly use it to refer to any unpleasant experience or circumstance that we have to endure. We say, this is the cross I'm called to carry. But the people of Jesus' time knew that if they saw a man literally carrying a cross, or the crossbar of a cross on his shoulder, they were seeing a man who was on his way to his execution. So what Jesus is saying is that discipleship with him means a death to the self-life. The deal he offers us is, you give your life to me, and I will give my life to you. So what gives him the right to make such absolute claims upon us? First of all, who he is God. Secondly, what he has done for us. To serve us and to save us, he exchanged the glory of heaven for the womb of a virgin, for the squalor of the stable, for the toil of Nazareth, for the stresses of public ministry, for the opposition of sinners, for the unimaginable darkness of the cross as our sins were laid on him, for the pangs of death and the coldness of the grave. He gave absolutely everything for us. Does that not give him the right to ask everything from us? In the course of our lifetime, we have many times sung the lines, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Jesus wants to know if we really mean them. So he says to us, don't rush into a shallow emotional response to me. Carefully consider if you're ready for the kind of commitment I'm asking of you. Count the cost. And to help us do that, he uses two illustrations. First of all, a man who's contemplating a building project. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Now, the word literally does mean tower, but it can also be used of a farm building. So to these people in a crowd which would probably have contained many farmers, Jesus says, if you're thinking of building a new steading, you won't rush into that project without first sitting down to calculate how much the whole building will cost, so as to make sure you have enough funds to finish it. If you get the foundations laid and then have to stop there, you'll be the laughingstock of the whole neighborhood. Notice Jesus' emphasis on finishing. In terms of our Christian discipleship, Jesus is anxious to know if we have enough commitment, not just to get us started in a flush of enthusiasm, not just to take us part of the way and then give up, but to stick with him for the whole of the journey, right to the end. That's the kind of disciples he's looking for. And he uses a second illustration. First, a building project, then another expensive undertaking, a military campaign. He says, suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Now, this illustration is not an exact parallel of the first. In the first, the man could choose whether or not to embark on his building project. In this second illustration, the king is facing a crisis that he didn't ask for, but which he must respond to. Another king is coming against him with an army that is vastly superior to his. So he must make a calculation. Can I defeat this man with the resources I've got, or must I go for the diplomatic option and sue for peace? Now, Jesus is reminding us here that you and I will one day face a crisis encounter with another king, an encounter with our God, when the only thing that will matter will be whether or not we are at peace with him. And we can only be at peace with him if we are disciples of Jesus and have him as our Saviour. As Paul says in his letter to the Romans, being justified, being put into a right relationship with God by faith, faith in Jesus, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, with the first illustration, Jesus is asking us, can you afford to be my disciple? Can you bring to it that level of commitment and perseverance that it requires? With the second illustration, is asking us, in view of the coming crisis, can you afford not to be my disciple? And Jesus concludes his challenge to these apparently enthusiastic crowds with his reference to salt and the uselessness of salt that has lost its saltiness. In Jesus' time, salt was very often an impure mixture from which the actual salt could dissolve away, leaving a substance that looked like salt but had none of the tang or preservative potency of the real thing. As such, it was totally useless. So what is Jesus saying here? He's saying that professed supporters who lack a genuine and wholehearted commitment to him are useless to him, useless to his church, useless to the world, as far as their Christian impact goes. In chapter 3 of the book of Revelation, the ascended Christ passes his verdict on the Christian congregation at Laodicea, among others. This was the kind of congregation that would probably have received a good quinquennial report from the presbytery, financially prosperous and apparently successful. But how does Jesus see these people? He says, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. What was lacking with these people? What was lacking was an ardent commitment to Jesus himself. That is the really vital element in any congregation's life, without which everything else is valueless. So if we lack commitment, not only do we bring no joy to Jesus' heart, we bring no joy to our own heart. Jesus is asking each one of us today, in view of all that I have given and all that I have done, and that is what is said before us in the communion, how much am I worth to you? Are you willing to yield all and be my disciple? Not just in a fleeting burst of enthusiasm, but all the way, day by day, to the end of the road. And may he bless to us this meditating on his word. And now as we go on to the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, we're going to sing some verses from hymn 582. We'll sing verses 1 to 3 and verses 5 and 6. In love, from love, thou camest forth, O Lord, sent from the Father his incarnate word, that in that perfect name, by thee confessed, our hearts with thine might find their perfect rest. And while we're singing this hymn, the elders will bring forward the symbols of Christ's body broken and his blood shed. So we sing verses 1 to 3, verses 5 and 6 of 582. In love, from love, thou camest forth, O Lord.
Thank you.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Please be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, it is right that we call to mind the meaning of this supper. It is a remembrance of the sacrifice of Christ for the sin of the world, an encounter with the risen Lord, a feeding on him in faith, a communion with one another in his body, the church, a looking forward to the day when he will come again. Therefore, we need to come in faith, conscious of our weakness, renouncing our sin, humbly putting our trust in Christ, and seeking his grace. So come to this sacred table, not because you must, but because you may. Come not to testify that you are righteous, but that you sincerely love our Lord Jesus Christ and desire to be his true disciples. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Not because you have any claim on heaven's rewards, but because in your frailty and sin, you stand in constant need of heaven's mercy and help. We remind ourselves of the institution of this sacrament. The Apostle Paul was perturbed that the Christians at Corinth were somewhat disorderly in aspects of their worship, including their celebration of the Lord's Supper, so he sought to correct them by impressing upon them what Jesus himself had commanded. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 he writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me.' For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." As the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, we take these gifts of bread and wine to be set apart from all common uses to this sacred use and mystery. And as he gave thanks and blessed, let us draw near to God and offer him our prayers and thanksgiving. Let us pray. Our eternal, loving God and Father, we come before you to adore your great majesty. We marvel at your limitless power, your unfathomable wisdom, your unsullied holiness, and your perfect justice. You are and eternally shall be Lord over all, worshipped and adored by sinless angels and by ransomed saints. What most fills our hearts with joy and wonder is your amazing love, whereby in Christ your Son you have paid the inestimable price of our salvation. We cannot adequately praise you for such a gift, that he should come into our human flesh, so that in his own perfect person he should bear the unspeakable burden of the world's sin. We thank you that here today the symbols of bread broken and wine poured out speak to us of that costly sacrifice and invite us afresh at the foot of his cross to look believingly to him and to say, "Plenteous grace with thee is found, grace to cover all my sin. Let the healing streams abound make and keep me pure within. Thou of life the fountain art, freely let me take of thee. Spring thou up within my heart, rise to all eternity. So send down your holy people, send down your Holy Spirit to bless us and these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread which we break may be for us the communion of the body of Christ, and the cup of blessing which we bless, the communion of the blood of Christ, that we, receiving them by faith, may be made partakers of his body and blood, to nourish us and help us grow in grace, to the glory of your most holy name. Unite us now with all your believing people as we say the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. According to the holy institution, example, and command of our Lord Jesus, and for a memorial of him, we do this, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had blessed and given thanks, he broke it, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you, do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Take, eat, this is the body of Christ which is broken for you. Do this remembering him. This cup is the new covenant sealed by Christ's blood, which was shed that the sins of many might be forgiven. Drink from it, all of you. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, and his blood which was shed for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who find refuge in him.